always good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. It's always good to proclaim his goodness. You know, when you think about how good God is, one of the things I love about shopping for calendars, they got a lot of ones as Christians, you know, it's got verses on them. You know, you can get one of horses, you can get one of cars and Elvis and everybody else. But there's something about each month when they got a scripture on there and a beautiful photograph. There's something that does. So every month when you look at it, and we write a lot of things on our calendar. And this was actually on our calendar, Psalm 65, verse 11. And this is out of the Amplified Version. It says, you, of course we're talking about God here, you crown the year with your bounty and goodness. The tracks of your chariot wheels drip with fatness. And I thought, you, God, you're going to crown this year, think about it, the year with your bounty and goodness. Let's think about that. And you know, and as you, a lot of times at the start of the year, when you read your devotions and stuff, I do them every morning, it never fails. Jeremiah 29:11 always comes up. I love that scripture. It's one that's good to memorize. And there's so many different versions. I have an app that has so many different versions. And sometimes they bring out a little bit different in how they explain things. But I just love, this is the traditional King James Bible, Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. I love that. Okay? And this is another, this is the International Standard Version. For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for well-being, not for calamity, in order to give you a future and a hope. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. I just love that. And I love this one too. This is God's words translation. I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. They are plans for peace and not disaster. Plans to give you a future filled with hope. Now, just think about that. It's filled with hope. Now, one of the things that we want to always realize, that God wants us to feel that way, that we're filled with hope. No matter what the situation may be, we are filled with hope. Even if it's a situation that is not the best, like I love this in Isaiah 6, because it starts out kind of in a tough position. Because Isaiah chapter 6, I'm reading out Amplified, and this is Isaiah. It said, that King Uzziah died. So it's going to start with a bad situation, you know. In the year that King Uzziah died, in a vision, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne high and lifted up, and the skirts of his train filled the most holy part of the temple. Above him stood the seraphim, each had six wings, with two each, covered his own face, with two each covered his feet, and with two each flew. And one cried to another and said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts, the whole earth is full of his glory. Tonight, let's think about his fullness. Think about what God has done. As we go into this next year, you know, as we look in 2017, I know people make resolutions, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. It's always, you know, weight's always a big one, or, you know, we're going to exercise more, we're going to save money. But what about declaring that we're going to live a more holy life? That we're going to be more of a witness for him. That we're going to be more of a light. We're going to pray more. We're going to spend time more. That's what really attracts people, is when you live that life, when you are willing to stand up and say, I declare I am a Christian. If somebody asks you that, see, I never did like really the hem-haws, you know. Do you believe in God? Yeah, yeah, I'm into the God thing. I had somebody tell me that one time. Oh, he's got talking about Christianity, believing in God. Yeah, that God thing's all right. That's what I remember, the God thing. I was in Florida. God thing. And he kept thing. It's like, not a thing. It's not a person. Okay? Jesus Christ was a person. He's every bit God, every bit man. He's a holy God. Amen. He came down here for us. He died for us. If he died for us, surely we can live for him.
Amen.
Now, so it's not just a thing. It's not just something that we kind of just pass through, because we've all been at those places in our life where, you know, we prayed so much, you cried so much that you almost, your tears just run out and you're still crying. But you know what I love about God the most is that God hears that. He hears the cry of your heart. And he loves you. He wants the best. That's one thing, too, as I've been praying New Year, that I feel that God wants us to be more of encouraging to one another.
Yes.
To be able to lift up one another. And I know I sometimes get up here and I speak some of the same things because it's still in my heart. We should never, ever tell people they won't ever amount to nothing. There's people that do that. You don't know what God has in store for you. You don't know. Some come out of the worst circumstances. Some seems like, man, they can never get to where they're going. The odds are against them, you know? But they're never against them when you got God on your side.
Amen.
How are you going to do that? The Bible says, you know, who can be against us, right? Who can be against? If God be for us, who can be against us? God makes things a majority.
Right.
You know, that my I just think about the other day, my cousin, he used to drive a cab out in Los Angeles, you know, and the city of Los Angeles said, "Wasn't you scared of all the gangs, man? You know, all the gangs." And I never forget what he said. He said, "Tim, God is my gang." So that's what I'm telling you. I got God on my side. I ain't afraid. How am I supposed to be full of fear when I got God? That's what it really wants to take. God is. He's like, you know, just setting up a standard. It's just like the time of Moses, you know. Who's on the Lord's side?
Right.
It's getting to, you see all the stuff happening in this world. It's like God's lining them up. Who is on my side? Who believes in me? It's time to get serious. Do you really serious? I might take you over here, and like Suzanne was talking, it might be uncomfortable. That's all right when God goes with me. You remember when Deborah and they was going to go fight, and the general said, "Well, you go over here." And he says, "Like, tell you what, I ain't going unless you're going." Let me tell you, he understood that God was with Deborah. She was a judge, so you need to go too. I ain't going unless you're going. And that's where it's about, you know? And it's about when God's leading. I love that. You know, that's why we need to bathe every situation we have in prayer first. Can't stress that enough. It has helped me through my life, especially as I got older. I learned to pray first. God, do you want me to do this? Do you want me to do this? Do you want me to not do this? You know, I tell you what, it saves you from a lot of heartaches. It really does. Just taking that time. And the last thing, one of the things I think is so important, when you do your prayer time, it's just great to go to God and have no request. There's nothing wrong with it. There's nothing wrong. It's nothing wrong to ask God. But sometimes it's nice just to go to God and say, "You know what, God? I'm not going to ask for anything today. You know what I'm going to do? I'm just going to spend this time thanking you."
Amen.
And praising you.
Amen.
And appreciating you and valuing you. I tell you what, that turns a whole lot of things around. You remember when the 10 lepers got healed? You know? And can you imagine? I mean, leprosy, we all have been aware of that, you know? And they're going away from Jesus. They're all healed and they're going away. And they're, you know, starting to look at their body and thought, wow, you know, their skin, everything's been healed. But isn't it amazing? Only one of the 10. Can you imagine? One of them looked, whoa, wow,
yeah.
Wow. Man, I got to go back. I need to go back and thank God.
Yeah.
And he come back to him. Jesus, wasn't there 10 of you?
Yeah.
There's only one came back. Because that one other stood, and he's healed, but he was healed totally from the inside out. Sometimes we get the healing on the outside, you know, and God just does great things. I got to share this with you, if indulge me. I got to say this.
Come on.
I work with a guy, and he had a motorcycle wreck. And they did not take him from the site of the motorcycle wreck to the hospital. They took him to the morgue. You know what that means?
Mm-hmm.
He's gone. When they tag your big toe, you're gone. Well, he was in the morgue, and guess what? He woke up. Now, I'm telling you what, when I heard that, you talk about sending little chills to you.
Yeah.
Brother, you're pretty close to going out to the graveyard when going to morgue, let me tell you. So one day at work, I had a bunch of Bible tracts, and there was evangelists coming to town here. So I just passed them out, anybody that wants them. So we was walking from one building to another. And I remember, I said, here, would you like a Bible tract? And he grabbed it from me, and he tore it up. And he wrinkled up and said, don't you ever talk to me about God anymore. Oh, man. Well, I'm telling you, that hurt, buddy. I didn't feel like doing evangelism after that, let me tell you. I mean, that really, dude, because I already knew the story of him nearly going out in eternity and being lost forever. He's going to act like that? And I thought, brother, man, you don't know how long, you know, I mean, just a little bit longer, and you go in eternity without God, and here's an opportunity. I never forgot that, and I was in the evangelism explosion at the time, and I remember talking to some people about that. Said, Tim, don't you be offended, because it's not you personally. Right. It's the God that lives in you.
That's right.
That's what he has to deal with. That's what he's seeing. The track is just you reaching out. It's God reaching out to him. You keep praying for him. Don't take it personally. But let me tell you, folks, when somebody attacks my God, it's hard not to take it personally. Yeah. You know, and it took me a while to get over it, but you kind of get over it and realize that's just one person and that's all I can do. But I tell you, once they slip out of here in eternity, you only got two directions you go, up or down, you know? That's it. That's it. And I thought about that, and that told me that, you know what? As this year, as we grow in God and we seek holiness and we seek more of him, you know, it's also going to lead us to be able to share more. And realize there's a lot of people that are hurting. They might not tell you. And one of the best things we can do in evangelism is just invite people to church. That's it. We don't have to give them the Roman roadmap. Sometimes there's time to do that. But sometimes tell you, you know what? God's got a purpose for your life. Why don't you come to church and hear about Jesus Christ? Why don't you come to church? Because the best thing, you know, people can argue, they can argue, you know, facts in the Bible, they'll argue this and argue, but they can't argue one thing, and that's what God did to your life. I know the before and after of 10, okay? Nobody can take that away from me. And you look in the Bible, and you see how many people that God changed and God used. You think about Paul, I mean, and think about the change that Paul took that happened in his life. You know, and you see how God used him for the remainder of his life and turn him around, repent. You know, it was about face. Paul, I got a plan for your life. You no longer Saul, but now you're Paul, because I'm going to use you. So as we go tonight and we think about how good God is, just remember, no matter what situation is going through, remember, God is high and lifted up. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So we're going to go ahead and open this up with prayer. I appreciate prayers. We're planning on going out of town for visit the grandkids. And I always pray for traveling merchants, because I go up and down the highway so long, things can change in just a second. The weather can change. Situation can change. I don't never take nothing for granted. We always get in the car and we pray going down, pray coming back, you know, so everything goes well, because that's always important. Other prayer requests or praises? Yes, Mike.
Yeah, just thank the Lord that the city David has been getting better and better.
Good.
All praying for her. The daughters and the grandkids have stepped up the top of while with God.
Good.
Right now, it's a good situation. Thank you all for the prayers for my travel down with my kids. It was abundantly more than expected, because not only did I get to spend some awesome time with my son and daughter and their families, but also my youngest daughter, whom I hadn't seen in 26 years. I
wow.
Got to see her several times too, so.
Praise the Lord.
We're breaking through, and the Lord reminded me that I was going into a spiritual enemy's camp to take back what the enemy stole, and I knew that when I left, and after I got to spend time with my son and daughter, from New Year's midnight till 3 in the morning out by a bonfire, just talking heart to heart to heart, and just breaking down some walls and stuff like that, we spent time at the last hour just worshiping the Lord, just praising
Hallelujah.
God, glorifying under my feet. Satan is on my feet. Yet we went to the enemy's camp and took back what he stole from us. So
hallelujah.
My daughter, my son, at one point in time, after talking and about truth, about things like that, just got three of us just hugging each other so hard and stuff like that. My daughter, I don't know how long she cried, but she cried it out for at least 10 or 15 minutes. I got my daddy back. I got my daddy back.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Praise God. Praise God for that. And he's awesome.
Praise God. You know, there's one thing for sure that God's all about, and that's family. You know, he loves to see when families get reconciled or when there's a difference, and he loves to see that coming together. He loves that unity when they come, because I tell you what, that's what it matters most. You know, I know I share, but I've never yet, I've had people on their deathbed, and I never had one person say, hey, I wonder how my 401k is doing. I've never had a person ask about that. You know, make sure you polish my Rolls Royce out there, will you? Make sure it's all shined up, you know. Not one time have I said, can you make sure my kids? I want to see my kids. I want to see my grandkids. I want to hug them one more time. That's what I see at the end. Because they realize that's what's more important, that time. Because you can't get it back anymore. You just can't get it back.
Amen.
And family, what it's all about. Amen. Yes. Someone else. Yes.
With that being said, when I visited my Aunt Mary down in Kentucky the last time, there was a gal that married a guy from Henderson that lived in Knoxville, Iowa here. And they're ministers, and they came in and prayed an anointed prayer with my aunt. And she's back here now.
Frank and Michelle, yep. We'll definitely pray for them.
Yep.
Yep. That's what the church is designed for, too. To pray one for another, to lock arms, you know, and pray and believe. You know, when you get in that unity, I mean, it's powerful. Yes, ma'am.
My daughter did mention one thing down there. My son is also in agreement that they've been trying to find a church within 10 miles, 15 miles where they're at, and they just cannot find one that just will not reveal the fullness of God's love and truth and stuff like that. When my daughter visited here, she said, Daddy, if I was living here, this would be my church. And they just cannot find one like this church down there. So they're thinking about starting their own church.
Well, hallelujah. Hallelujah.
So, whatever it takes.
Yep. Amen. Yep. And sometimes that's what you have to do.
Yep.
Get the believers together and preach the true word.
Gotcha.
I mean, we all know that sometimes there's a lot of stuff out there. But, you know, the thing is, when you seek God and seek his direction, and Jesus Christ is the word,
yes,
you know,
right.
So you're preaching what Jesus Christ is, I tell you what, that's powerful. And you don't always hear. Sometimes you hear some personal development preaching. You know, you hear some stuff like that. But to get inside... Get inside and change people. That's what the word really is designed to do.
Yes.
To change people.
Yes, right.
And have them be a reflection of Christ.
Amen.
That is a big difference.
Yes.
You know, Alice in Wonderland, I never got any guidance out of Alice in Wonderland.
No.
You know. You know, or reading Peanuts cartoons. I you know, sometimes there's some spiritual things in there that flow through there, but I'm telling you what, they didn't do nothing like the word of God. They didn't do nothing. They didn't cause me to fall down on my knees like the word of God. Hallelujah. 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 All right. Someone else. Yeah, winter can be kind of hard season, you know, but it don't last forever. That's a good thing. I drove a truck for years, and you know, I had the high temperature was 15 below. That was a high that day without the wind chill, you know. So it was 30, 40 below zero, and you're out there driving a truck, and Day what? It's a Yeah. Isn't that something? Oh, yeah. We understand. We understand. Anybody else? Okay. Well, let's go ahead and stand for prayer, please. Oh, Father God, it's about you because you are high and lifted up. Oh, hallelujah. But this year you have crowned with goodness. Oh, hallelujah. That you think those thoughts, hallelujah, of us to give us a future and a hope. And Lord, let us never forget that. No matter what the circumstance may be, things may not look good sometimes, but the one thing about it is, God, you are still there no matter what. Your word said, hallelujah, never seen the righteous forsaken. David said, I was young, but now I'm old, yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken or seed begging bread. And you are our wonderful counselor, hallelujah, our mighty God, the one that listens to us, that one that loves us with an everlasting love. In the beginning, God, you are the Word. Lord, we're going to line every area of our life up with your Word. Because it's all about you, God. Lord, we thank you that Mike had a safe trip to spend time with his family. Because you are about family. You created us, Lord, in your image. Oh, and you walked in the cool of the day with Adam and Eve to spend time with the family. Lord, let us never forget that. Lord, Father God, we want to thank you for the families that are represented here tonight. We know that this cold day can keep some from getting out. We understand that. But touch their homes. Touch their lives. Meet all their needs, Lord. Hallelujah. Continue to be with Cindy, Lord, and the family, Lord. Continue to work in her life. Be with Myron's life. Be with all the healing that needs to take place here. That, Lord, you would bless the congregation financially and spiritually, every way that they need. Sometimes a request that they go unspoken, but the thing about it, that we know that you know what's in our hearts. You know what we desire the most. We know, hallelujah, that, Lord, you are working all things together for the good of those that love God. And we love you today. We love you so much, Lord. We thank you for the pastor and the missus. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for the dedication of them here at this church. We thank you for every member that's here today. And the ones that couldn't be here, we thank you for this body that prays one for another. That we can lock arms and say we come to agreement, because in your word says where there's two or three touching and agreeing that you're going to be in the midst. And as Isaiah saw in King Uzziah died, he saw you high and lifted up, and a train filled the temple. And Lord, as the servant cried, holy, 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 let us cry, holy, holy, holy. Because you are holy. Lord, tonight, work in our lives. Continue to work in our homes. Continue to let us work and be reflections of you. That people can see the way we talk, that we reflect you. The way we look, we reflect you. That there's a light. Just like Moses had to put a veil because his face shined so much. Because he spent time with you. And Lord, let us spend that prayer time, part of it just thanking you and thanking you and thanking you for being such a good and holy God. And tonight as we go into the service, Lord, just reveal yourself more and more and more. Put your arms around everyone that's here today. Let them know how much you love them. And how much you have great plans for their life. They're never too young, never too old to get started.
That's right. That's right.
Moses was 80 when he hit the ground running. The Bible said he turned aside when he saw the burning bush. Sometimes that's what it takes in our life to have a burning bush or something to turn us aside from all the other stuff and turn toward you, realizing, God, when you're here, we are on holy ground. Hallelujah. Father God, thank you for this opportunity to come and praise you. Lord, we thank you that we can come into your house and worship you. Because, Lord, it is all about you. As John the Baptist said, hallelujah, I must decrease so you can increase. That's what it's about. So that, God, you get bigger and bigger and bigger in our lives. Lord, we thank you and we praise you for this time of prayer and praise. Worship, and as we continue, that you would be high and lifted up, and we thank you in your wonderful holy name. Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. And if you would be so kind to turn off your cell phones, the Eastern Gatehouse of Prayer is January 13th at 7 p.m. here at the church. So, want to. Add anything?
I see starting blocks lined all through this place. The race is starting now. We're going to launch. We're going to launch hard. The Lord's already got to get it up in the air, and he's ready to pull the trigger. Y'all get here. Something's up. Something's going to be wild and crazy. I just know it's going to be whatever it takes. Whatever it takes. Whatever it takes. I keep hearing women's of influence. I hear that conference being in this place. I hear so much. And these things need to be all prayed about. So just come, the Lord. It's almost like we're going to HQ, and the Commander in Chief is going to reveal his tactics and his plans.
Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Thank you. All right, now we're going to speak the word. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs who follow me, in the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Hallelujah. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection which God created to function, and I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but I am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. Hallelujah. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servants, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Brother Ron, would you be so kind to come up and bless the offering for us, please? Thank you.
Thank you. Praise God. Let's rejoice together right now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You are a great and a mighty God. Hallelujah. There is no God but you. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Regardless of how man sees you, Lord, you are high and lifted up. Praise God. And one day every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that you are Lord and God Almighty. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for revealing it to us. Thank you for your grace that made it possible for us to have this revelation of your great love. We thank you for it, Lord. In all eternity, we'll be filled with thanksgiving for your goodness and your grace. And everybody said, in Jesus' name, amen. Praise the Lord. Give him a hand this evening. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Amen. God bless you. Thank you, Suzanne. Thank you, Tim, for opening. Thank you, James. And thank you, Mike. Great to have you back. And so glad it was a prosperous trip and in every way. Praise the Lord. So, hallelujah. Doesn't get any better than that. And being able to reconnect with family and have God right in the middle of it, that's as good as it gets. Praise the Lord. So, thank the Lord. Amen. I was talking to Carol earlier, and as you heard her talking about how cold it is, and I mean, come on, it is cold. It's been cold the last few days. It was bitter cold again this morning. I got up, I was telling her, I got up to take the trash out to the street. Tomorrow's trash day where we live. I was going to take the trash can out to the street. And I opened the door, and I told Sally, I said, it is not fit for man or beast out there. So I sent her out with the trash. Man or beast. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Now let that be a lesson to all of you. Praise God. Amen. So I'd like to get right to the Word of God tonight, and we'll try to be brief and get you out of here so you can get back to your warm homes and get a good night's sleep and get up and face that frigid north wind again tomorrow. Praise the Lord. But it is going to be better. It's going to be in the double digits by the weekend. I think they said in the 20s at least, and mid-20s Saturday and Sunday. So it's almost balmy here in Iowa at this time of the year. So it'll be good. And warm weather next week. So Carol's going to get her prayer answered. It's going to be up in the low 40s at least for a couple of days next week. So praise the Lord. That'll be short weather again. Hallelujah. All right, John chapter 10, verse 10 is where I'd like to begin tonight. John 10, 10. Like riding a bike, Mike, it'll come right back to you. Yeah. I know I've pushed a few of myself. But. Praise God. Here we go. The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. Praise the Lord. All right, now keep that in mind. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 4 and we'll read verses 4 through 6. Ephesians 4, verses 4 through 6. So there's one body, one spirit, even as you're called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all who is above all and through all and in you all. Praise the Lord. So John 10:10 says that it's the purpose of God to come in the flesh was to give us life and to give us that more abundantly. So we could extrapolate from that human fullness is exactly what God is after. The fullness of what we can be in this world. That's what Jesus was. He was completely human, but he was filled with the Spirit of God. He was the fullest human that has ever lived. I mean, the most complete human outside of Adam that has ever lived on this planet. And he was greater than Adam. Amen. So he said, I've come that they may have life and have it to the full, or some translations more abundantly. But he's saying life to the fullness of life. Amen? So think about that. God doesn't want us stuck in a rut. God wants us to be free, free to abound and more than abound. Amen? To have more than enough. Amen? Not only are each of us called to be part of a unique life, he says here, but God is able in each of our unique lives to adapt and improvise each of our lives to the purpose that he has preordained for us.
Amen.
Amen? He knows. He knew before the foundation of the world what our life would be. Now, we have a free will, so we can deviate from that plan from time to time. But God can adapt and adjust, and he's done it in all of our lives if we've come to the Lord, right? So he has a way of adapting and adjusting our lives to fulfill that purpose that he has preordained for each one of us. Amen? So let's go back to Ephesians 4:4. He says, there is one body, one spirit, even as you are called, and one hope of your calling. So we're called by Jesus to walk with Jesus, to be one with Jesus. Amen? To represent Jesus to this world. That is part of what God has designed for each one of us. It's what Tim was talking about earlier. We need to maybe refocus every year, probably every day, for what our real purpose is here and why God has allowed us this time and this space on this planet. Amen? Because God isn't calling us to just live our lives. God is calling us to live specific lives for the purpose of his glory and our ultimate happiness. The two are one.
Amen.
When God receives his glory, our happiness is fulfilled, and vice versa. When we are completely the human that he created us to be, God is glorified as a result of it.
Amen.
Amen. And we are fulfilled in the process. Amen. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 10. So for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Right? So God had this plan, and he's already got it designed for each one of us. So before we were ever born, God made a plan to save us so that we could do the good things that he already had planned for us. Praise the Lord. I like the way God works. Amen. Remember the analogy I used, the metaphor I used of the tuning fork?
Yes.
This is what God is talking about here. The rhythm of our lives have to match God's rhythm. When that happens, God is glorified and we are fulfilled. We are complete in him. We are filled with joy, happiness. We abound with life. Amen? If God is God, and we know that he is, then there are plans and purposes that God has for each one of our lives. It's not a crapshoot. I mean, it's not random that we're here and that we're where we are, when we are, and who we are. It's all part of a purpose and a plan that God has. Let's just look at a couple of things here. Isaiah chapter 55, I want to read verses 8 through 13. Isaiah 55, 8 through 13. My thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain cometh down and the snow from heaven, and returneth not thither, but watereth the earth, maketh it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. Before I go on, there's two ways of looking at this, like there always is with the word. First of all, God sent his word.
Yes.
Came forth from God. The word was with God. The word was God. That word came forth, and it accomplished everything that God intended it to accomplish. Jesus did exactly what he intended to do when he reached this earth.
Yes.
And he went back to the Lord. And it didn't avoid, it didn't null or void anything that he did. He accomplished all of his purpose. Well, that's one way of looking at it, and that's a valid way of looking at it. But also the word the written word, the word that we then take and speak, is the same way. It works the same way. Amen. For as the rain comes down, the snow from heaven returneth not thither, but watereth the earth, and maketh it bring forth a bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It will not return unto me void, but it will accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. Jesus did, and the word will continue to do that, amen, if we operate in agreement with it. All right? For ye shall go out with joy and be led forth with peace. The mountains and the hills shall break forth before you into singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the fir tree, and instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle tree, and it shall be to the Lord for a name, for an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. I say that's 2017. That it kind of just parallels everything that God has been speaking to different ones in the church. Amen. In fact, probably all of us. But here's the interesting thing. Obviously this particular scripture, and most of Job, and a lot of the Psalms, and pretty much every time Jesus talked to his disciples, those scriptures and others tell me two truths. I can't always understand God, and God knows I can't always understand him. Praise the Lord. Amen. We don't have to be uptight and nervous because we don't understand everything that God's doing. We just got to trust God.
Amen.
Amen. So we have to walk by faith. Because of that reality, we're forced to walk by faith if we're going to live for God. And without faith, it's impossible to please God, and the just shall live by faith.
Yes.
Amen. So if we're living this way, we'll walk this way. We'll walk in faith. Amen. And you know what the huge problem is when it comes to walking by faith? It's a rhetorical question, so I'm not waiting for an answer.
Right.
It's that we have to walk by faith. Praise the Lord. Pretty deep, right? But it's true. I thought a lot about that. Amen. Over the years. That's the big problem. That's the huge issue, is that ultimately, no matter what you want to do, if you're going to live for God, at some point you're going to have to walk by faith.
Right.
And the sooner you do it, the sooner you get to the place in God that he wants you to be, to where he can actually do the things that he wants to do in your life and through your life.
Yes.
So Jesus isn't asking us to pass some kind of a test about what God wants. And then we start living. Look at Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 2. Some people wait all their lives trying to figure out what God wants. They never move on. Amen? So looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Amen?
Amen.
So people are trying to figure out God and find out what God wants, and then I'll start living. Amen? No. He tells us just look to Jesus.
Amen.
You want to walk by faith? There's your model. There's how you do it. You look to Jesus. You put your focus on him. He's the author and the finisher of our faith. Amen?
Amen.
Jesus said anybody that had seen him had seen the Father.
Yes.
Jesus is God with skin on. Amen?
Yes.
Jesus is the theology of the Father. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 18. So some people, they're waiting for a sign. They're waiting for this. They're waiting for that. They're waiting for to pass the test to understand everything that God's doing and why God's doing it. And I'm just saying that's not what he's demanding. Amen? In fact, here he says, but the path of the just, that'd be us, the righteous, those who've been justified, amen, is as the shining light that shineth more and more under the perfect day. So we can start while the path is still dim. I mean, while it's still murky and unclear and not completely lit. Amen? We can still walk in trusting that God will continue to reveal what's needed. And his word is a lamp unto our feet.
Yes.
If you walk according to the word or in agreement with the word, it'll light that path. Jesus, again, is the word. So that's another parallel here, but he says, but the path of the just is as a shining light that shineth more and more under the perfect day. God becomes more understandable the more we focus on Jesus. The more we look to Jesus, the more we realize and have revelation of God.
Amen?
Amen? Praise the Lord. So 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 4. Who will have all men to be saved? This is the will of God. And to come unto the knowledge of the truth. So based on the scriptures we've already read and then this scripture, here's what I want for 2017 to begin with, because I think everything else flows from this.
Yes.
I just want to get out there and walk.
Yeah.
Amen. I just want to trust the Lord. I just want to believe in His goodness. I just want to believe that every day new things are going to be opened up to us.
Yeah.
God's going to reveal more and more so that we can more fulfilled lives, so that He can be greater gloried. Amen.
Yes.
And if I do that, if we do that, there's two results. It'll be unpredictable, and it'll be good.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
The Spirit is infinitely creative. Obviously, He created everything.
Yep.
The Spirit hovered over the earth.
Mm-hmm.
He spoke, and all things become. So you don't sign up to follow Jesus because you know what's going to happen. If you thought that's what was going to take place, you got surprised already, didn't you? Multiple times for most of us, amen? But you take a leap of faith. Because you know, like the story in Narnia, you know, he may not be safe, but he's good.
Yes.
He may not be predictable, but the outcome will always be good for you if you trust him.
Amen.
Ephesians chapter 4 again. Let's read verses 4 through 6 once more. See, there is one body, one Spirit, even as you're called, and one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. One God and Father of all, who is above all, and through all, and in you all.
Amen.
So we're called to travel the same road. It's life. It's called life here. And in the same direction, forward, prophetically,
yes,
according to the Word of God, in agreement with the Word of God,
amen,
which is all prophecy.
Mm-hmm.
Enjoy. Live. Everything we are and think and do is permeated by oneness.
Yes.
I'll never leave you or forsake you.
Glory.
I and the Father are one, you are one in Him and me. This is how it works. The more we understand it, the more we're fulfilled, the more God is glorified.
Amen.
There's a mystery here, for sure. But it's a good kind of mystery.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Let's close with this scripture, Ephesians 1, verses 4 through 12. Ephesians 1, 4 through 12. According as He hath chosen us in Him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy, without blame before Him in love, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to Himself, according to the good pleasure of His will, to the praise of the glory of His grace, wherein He hath made us accepted in the Beloved, in whom we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of His grace, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times He might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in Him, in whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of Him who worketh all things together after the counsel of His own will, that we should be to the praise of His glory, who first trusted in Christ. Can you say praise the Lord?
Praise
Amen.
The Lord.
Give the Lord a hand tonight. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. So let's just start walking, and He'll show the path. He'll light it up. Amen.
Amen.
We'll be fulfilled. He'll be glorified. And all things will be one in the Lord. Amen. God bless all of you. Appreciate you being out here on this cold night. God bless you. Have a safe trip home, and we'll hope to see you all back here Sunday. If you're not with us, God be with you wherever you are. Amen.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.